Lord, I know that when I pray, you have changed my husband. Maybe you're changing me, but Lord, you have drawn us closer together. Amen. Lord, I know that you can make a husband that we don't even respect into a husband that we respect. I know that you can take a husband who may be a gambler, an alcoholic, a husband, Lord, that may be philander with other women, Lord. You can change them because of a praying wife. Lord, we thank you for the power of prayer. Lord, we thank you for this privilege. And I know, Lord, that there is nothing that can change me and my husband and our marriage and our family except for prayer. Amen. It is the one thing that works more than counselors, more than anything else in the world. Just prayer, Lord. So we thank you that you are going to raise our husbands up into all that they can be. You are going to raise them up to be priests for you and for their family. Lord, I believe this for each wife here, for each of their husbands, because we are praying to you, our real husband in heaven. In Christ's name, amen.
Father in heaven, I pray for all the wives here today. As you have given us, Lord, a partner in life. Because, Lord, without our wives, we are incomplete. And we are, in some ways, insufficient, Lord, unable to carry out our task, Lord. You have said it is not good that man be alone. And you have created woman to stand by our sides, to teach us how to love, to teach us how to pray, to teach us how to reach out to people around us. Lord, I thank you for the wives, that all the women that you have created, that you have put into our lives. Lord, a man can be made through his wife because, Lord, she is praying for her husband. She is encouraging her husband to step out in faith as my wife has done for me. And Lord, sometimes our wives, they're even willing to suffer, Lord, to your glory and to your honor, Lord. Because, Lord, they understand that the most important thing in this world is to see Jesus come into clouds of glory. Amen. Our wives, Lord, I thank you that they make our home. They make our home happy. They make our home joyful. They make our homes beautiful. They make our homes smell good. Lord, there are so many benefits that our wives, that what they do for us, they help to shape our characters. And Lord, I pray for each wife here, Lord, that they will support their husband fully. I pray that the husbands will support their wives. Sometimes it is the wives who are more spiritual than the husbands. Sometimes it is the wives who are reaching out to the neighbors and bringing people to Jesus. I pray, Lord, empower these wives with your Holy Spirit, Lord, that they will encourage their husbands to pray more, to witness more, to experience you more, to reach out to their neighbors and friends, to raise their children to fear you and to love you. Lord, please help these wives, Lord. We are all at your mercy, O Lord. We ask this in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.
God bless every one of you, husband, wife, family, and marriage. And I can tell you, your lives will never be the same from today in Jesus' name. Amen. Enjoy your married life. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Meistersingers. That was beautiful. God bless. Now it's time for us to listen to a wonderful group of people who have traveled all the way from the Latin America. I want our Latin American group to kindly come forward as we enter into our next session of prayer. God bless every one of you who's here. We have several prayers. Do we have the Latin group here? Oh, here we go. Please come forward. Amen. We're going to have a health talk after this. You're all going to be empowered how to give hydrotherapy. That is going to be the first step as you're going to go from door to door in Tagaytay. God is going to use this beautiful health evangelism. Latino choir, may I humbly request you to come forward, please. Thank you so very much. Let's all put our hands together and welcome them. Thank you so very much. We are continuing to experience prayer waves. This time we are going to have three special prayers. This whole afternoon we are here just to pray, because there's nothing like banking on the power of prayer. I'm going to request three of them to come forward. Two of them happen to be my professors. I want Dr. Mora, Dr. Cruz to kindly come forward, along with one of my best friends, a prayer warrior of the Philippines. Jim, can you please come forward? We are so happy. I will tell you, we're going to have quick prayers, three prayers. The first prayer is exclusively for all the housewives. If you are a housewife, stand up right now. Don't feel shy. Praise the Lord. Not house husband, only housewife. If you are a housewife, right now, you're taking care. Many people don't pray for the housewives. I'm going to ask Dr. Cruz to kindly come forward and pray specially for all the housewives that God will bless them and touch them.
Let's pray. Shall we close our eyes? Father, we are here together as your children, part of your family, your global family, those who pray, those who trust in you. We are here because we trust that Jesus soon will come back to take us home. But while we stay here, while we are still living in this world, we need your blessings, Lord. We need your protection. We need your comfort. We need your peace. And especially now, we'd like to plead that you bless those who are at home, our sisters, who have a hard work, a lot of tasks during the day, a lot of things to do, children, cleaning, organizing, taking time, care of time, managing many things. Please, Lord, bless them. They are here because they love you. They are here because they are an extension of your love,
you,
an extension of your arms of love.
Amen.
Please fill them with your love, your presence, your spirit, so that they may be powerful instruments in your hands, in their places, in their homes, in wherever they are. We pray this in Jesus' name, the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Next, you may be seated. I'm going to call Dr. Mora to kindly step forward. We're going to have a special prayer for all the professionals. If you are a doctor, a lawyer, an engineer, an architect, it doesn't matter what, if you are a professional, we're going to pray that God is going to bless you and your profession. In Jesus' name, stand up. We're going to have prayer for you. If you're a professional, praise the Lord. Teachers, lecturers, professors, engineers, doctors, look at this. Adventist Church is blessed with professionals. Pastor Mora, can you pray for us?
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for this moment. Thank you for this Sabbath. Oh, Lord, you know the reason your church, your people are gathered in this place. We want to ask your power, your presence in our lives, that you clean our sins and we can be every day closer to you. And Lord, among us there are some brethren, some brothers and sisters who are professionals in their daily life. They have a big influence. They have a knowledge. And I want to ask that you can bless them. And as they have expressed in this moment, they want to put their talents, their gifts, their knowledge in your hands. Please use them for your glory. That we want to ask that through them, many people can be blessed, can know your word, can decide to be and walk with Jesus. Bless them in their personal lives, at their homes, and they can receive your blessings in all their activities with your with their families. Thank you, Lord, for these meetings, and give us your Holy Spirit, because we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
You may be seated. Our last prayer before we go for a break is exclusively for very special people. If you are under one of the following brackets, I want you to stand. We're going to pray for you. Number one, if you are a senior citizen, 60 years plus, you may stand right now. 60 years plus. Not 16, 60, 60. Number two, if you are a widow or a widower, you can also stand. If you are a widow or a widower, if you are 60 years, or a widow or a widower, we're going to have a special prayer. Jem, Castor, can you just intercede on our behalf? Talk to the Lord.
Shall we bow our heads for the prayer? Our great God, our dear loving Heavenly Father, we give you praise, we give you thanks because you are our Father. And Lord, we praise you and we thank you for our brothers and sisters who might not be young in age, but they are young at heart.
Thank you, Lord.
And Lord, we praise you and we thank you that you have given them the zeal and the fire to continue fighting this battle of life. And Lord, we praise you and we thank you because we know that you are standing close beside each and every one of them. Lord, we pray for a special blessing upon them. We pray, dear Father, that as the years goes on, as their strength fades, may they lean harder on you. And Lord, I pray that you please open the portals of heaven, that you pour upon them a double portion of your Holy Spirit, that in each and every day their walk would become sweeter, and that their communion with you would become clearer. And Lord, I pray in a very special way that you please use them powerfully for the glory of your name. We know, dear Father, that the Holy Spirit is no respecter of age, and there's no age limit in this ministry. So, dear Father, I pray that you please take a hold of these hearts that are still willing to be used in the for the glory of your name. Use them, dear Father, and I pray that as the year goes on, help them, dear Lord, to bring as many people as they can in whatever way possible. Lord, I pray that you please comfort them. For those who have lost their partners, may you remind each one of them, dear Father, that you are the greatest partner. And Lord, I pray that you please make your spirit manifest in their lives, and may their communion with you would be so sweet that as they leave each day, as they go out of their homes, that their faces will shine, that people will know that they have been with Jesus. Lord, we pray that you please take a hold of our hearts, give us an intense desire to know you, and give us this wonderful communion with you, that when people sees us, that they would want to have what we have. Lord, be with our brothers and sisters who are standing in front of you right now. Give them strength. And most especially, I pray, dear Father, that you please give them joy. Give them joy that comes from heaven, because we know that the joy of the Lord is our strength. This we ask, dear Father, in the loving name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you so much. That brings us to the end of the first session. We're going to have a break for 13 minutes right now. We have been sitting here for 2 hours 27 minutes. There's much more coming up. I'm also waiting for one of my professors. I got a call that he is caught in a traffic. I'm also hoping that God will clear the way, that he will be here. I'm looking forward to meet my professor very soon. There's much more coming up. We're going to have another 6 more prayer sessions, a health talk, and a consecration at the end by my professor, Dr. Ben Mergal. I'm waiting for him. Let's pray that God will bring him as early as possible. In a very special way, I want to request our final session for the next 1 hour, 40 minutes is very powerful. God is going to empower us with the Holy Spirit. May God bless you. As you go out, exit these doors, you will see the restroom for the ladies and for the gents who want to drink some water, but make sure you're here exactly in 13 minutes. It's only a 13 minutes literal break. God bless you. Let's meet right after the break. Thank you. Well, it's time for us to gather. I want to request all those at the back to kindly come forward. May I request the volunteers to kindly go out and bring all our outstanding members to come inside. Let us go into the presence of God. We have not much time. We're going to have a health talk. We're going to listen to some songs. We're going to pray. And then we have the consecration service. You're going to listen to a beautiful piece of consecration from the Word of God. And He's going to consecrate all of us, which will be in about after 1 hour. Can we just give about a minute? I want all of us to come here, gather and sit down. May I request all those at the back, our team members, to send everyone who is outside inside, please. Please. Let's gather here. We do not have much time to waste. Thank you. Thank you for your cooperation. Every minute spent in the presence of God is worth waiting for. It's always good to invest in the presence of God because God richly pays His dividends. Thank you. Thank you all for coming. We want all of you to come quickly. We're going to invite the Philippine Meistersingers. They have a very busy and a hectic schedule, but they're going to sing their last two grand finale songs. After that, they have to leave. Some of them on nurses. They have to go all the way to Manila. Thank you so very much. Meistersingers, want to listen to you. Please, everybody, walk up to the front. Take your seats. We're going to pray, and we will spend some time, and then we will depart. Thank you. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath po muli sa lahat. In behalf po ng Philippine Meistersingers, we would like to thank everyone, especially the organizers for having us here. Truly, all of us have been blessed by the program, and we hope we could stay more with you to finish the program, but since most of them are also working, so we have to leave after these last two songs. Sana po sa lahat ng narinig natin ngayong hapon, we want to bring back all the glory and honor to our Heavenly Father. May God bless us all.
Thank you. when the sky shall unfold, preparing his entrance, the stars will applaud him with thunder.
beyond the shadow of any doubt, I'm sure you'd all agree with me. This afternoon, it has been a tremendous privilege for us to have been the recipients of God's grace. And we have just been ushered into the very presence of God as we knelt down and prayed, had many sessions of prayer, saturated, punctuated with the wonderful singing. All what I want to say is we give God the glory. Thank you. Thank you. When I read the Bible, it says that 1/3 of the angels fell from heaven. I'm afraid most of them fell into this group. What a beautiful singing. I'm saying in the night, these are not fallen angels, but beautiful singing angels. Don't mistake me. Don't mistake me. These are singing angels. If you have been blessed this afternoon, before they step out of Summit Ridge, I have to say, most of them are students. Some of them have to go to Manila right now. We praise God. If you have been blessed, if you want to praise God, will you say amen for their ministry?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. May the Lord lead you to great heights. And we are looking forward to rub our shoulders with you in the near future. Let's make this place, Tagaytay, a better place. And whenever the Spirit of God impresses you, please come and serve for His glory. And can I also join your group for singing? Or you have audition? Okay, thank you so very much. Appreciate that. Praise God. Let's give them a round of applause. God bless. Thank you so much. One of the greatest challenges in our day-to-day life is health. Some of us suffer from arthritis, rheumatism, but we do not really know the natural remedies. This afternoon, for the next 20 minutes, you're going to be so blessed. Here is a wonderful, dedicated person. I specially invited her and told, ma'am, I want you to come and please demonstrate to us natural ways of healing. But before I call upon my friend, I want to call upon another colleague of mine, who is also a good friend of mine in the seminary, Pastor Roy Graff. He's going to pray specially for all of us who have health challenges, who are not keeping too well. I'm not going to embarrass you by asking you to stand up or raise your hand. If you have had some physical challenges, if you have been suffering, if you had some weaknesses, it doesn't matter what your weaknesses or what your sicknesses, will you please bow down your heads with Pastor Roy as he prays for all of us.
Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you because we have the privilege to stay before your presence in this evening. Thank you because we can present in freedom all our requests. You know, Father, we depend every day, every hour, every minute, every moment of you. We depend of your help, your assistance, and we are your children. You know, Father, as your children, we have many challenges. We have trials. We have difficult situations. And among them, we have to live several times. We have to deal with problems of health. Maybe we are here because we are suffering for some problem of health. Yes. Maybe we are here because some member of our family is striving, is fighting against some sickness, some problem of health. Maybe something that only you can cure. For that reason, our dear Father, in this opportunity, we want to ask you for your special intervention in our life. You know each one of us. You know our situation. Maybe we have some situation because we ignore natural laws that we should know, and we will learn more this afternoon or this evening about that. But maybe we have to deal with some situations that we cannot change for ourselves. You are the only one who can give us health. You are the only one who can heal us. Maybe some member of our family is with cancer. Maybe somebody is dealing with some problems in his or her heart. We don't know. I don't know, Father, but you know. And we want to ask you your special blessing, your hand upon each one of us. If there is somebody here who is in need of health, please cure him or her. Bless each one of us. If there is somebody in our family who is fighting against some sickness, please cure him or her. Please stay with us. Lead us in each aspect of our life. We put our life in your hands, and we ask you all these things, not because we deserve all of them, but because Jesus has died for us. We ask you in his name all these things. Amen.
Thank you, I want to call upon Ma'am Carrie Beats. Ma'am Carrie Beats is a professionally trained. She's got her amazing degree to the highest level from the United States. She's going to do a beautiful demonstration of the natural ways of healing, particularly using hydrotherapy. She's going to need the help of some volunteers. I want to come humbly request, if she calls for some volunteers, please do come, and she will be a great help. Let's all put our hands together and welcome Ma'am Carrie Beats. Thank you.
Good afternoon and happy Sabbath. Some of Christ's last words to his disciples were, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." Whether you have been blessed to grow up in the church, or whether you're somebody who had ears to hear and the Lord has called you, either way, as a faithful servant, you have a responsibility to pay it forward, to pass it on, the joy and the privilege of knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. You would be amazed at how many people do not know who Jesus Christ is. And even if they have a vague idea, they really don't know what the salvation plan is or anything about it. And the Lord has put it in our hands to be the ones to connect with them. As I speak at churches and I present to churches, I have found that people often do not become active in urban evangelism because aspects of it are outside of their comfort zone. If you're one of those people, even though the Lord may put you in his school for training, you just find that knocking on people's total strangers' doors to try and get them to let you come into their homes and give them Bible studies, or makes you very uncomfortable, it's outside of your comfort zone, or if you absolutely cringe at the thought of voluntarily walking into a prison to give either a class or a Bible study, I would suggest perhaps you need to learn hydrotherapy. Hydrotherapy is one of the two main methods of healing in spirit of prophecy. And it's phenomenal. Once you become familiar with it, there's almost nothing that it cannot treat successfully. It is one of God's ways of natural healing, and he totally blesses it. It is easy to do. It is highly effective, and it's very much in harmony with God's ways of doing things. So, that said, if you learn hydrotherapy and start using it in your own home and with your family members and yourself and with your friends, it will become within your comfort zone. And then you will have something that can be used for evangelism that's within your comfort zone, and the Lord can bring you people who you can not only help health-wise, but you can also share the gospel with. For today's demonstration, I'm going to show you a couple of very basic hydrotherapy treatments. And I'm going to need a volunteer who's willing to either roll up their pants legs to their knees or pull their skirt up to their knees. Do I have anybody willing to come up? Thank you. Yes, please. The official definition of hydrotherapy is the use of water in any of its three forms, which would be frozen or ice, as liquid, which is water, or vapor, for assisting the body and bringing the body into harmony. So the most common is using it in the water form. And if you go ahead and take your shoes off and roll your pants legs up, you can take your socks off if you want. We're going to pretend that we have water in the buckets today. So, because basically I think you need to, you mostly need to see how to do it. You don't actually need to see him get wet. So, the first thing we are going to we're going to show you just a simple hot foot bath. A hot foot bath is used for a number of things. It can be used for a congestive headache, such as having a cold, allergies, sinus problems, migraines, or sore throat where you have inflammation, chest congestion, bad menstrual cramps, or pelvic congestion, somebody who has chronically cold feet, if you have high blood pressure, or if you need to stop a nosebleed that isn't cooperating with other methods. Okay? So it's real simple. There are a few things that you don't use it for. There's something called vasculitis, which is the inflammation of the blood vessels, and if you have that in your legs, you don't use this treatment. If you have severe clogging of the arteries, arteriosclerosis, you don't use this treatment. Or if you've lost the feeling in your legs and you're numb, you don't use the treatment, okay? But other than that, it works for many things. And this is a bucket of hot water. Okay, hot water. Now you need a few, ideally you have you can do it by feel, but in particular if you're somebody that works with heat or you wash a lot of dishes or something like that, your hands may be pretty tolerant to heat. There's a couple of instruments that are helpful. Getting a plastic thermometer that can get wet, an indoor-outdoor thermometer, and this is one I bought here in the Philippines, to be able to test the water and know that it's within a certain temperature range is good. If you have old eyes like I do, then you get the big version with large numbers, okay? This one I brought with me from the United States. The other thing that it helps to have, you can just use a watch. If you have a clock with a second hand on it, that works too. But on this part, you don't need it too much. You can just do it with a clock. On our next one, you will need to be able to have a timer of some kind. Because if you're like me, and you're doing a treatment on a person, they start asking questions and things like that, and I lose track of the time, which isn't good. So, on this first one, it's not a problem because they're just gonna have their feet in the water for 20 minutes, but on the next one, it is a problem. So, I have a kitchen timer, and again, because I have old eyes, I have one that has great big digital numbers on it. But this is one that I brought with me from the United States, specifically because it had big digital numbers. But I have seen ones that are smaller here in some of the stores, so I know they are available. This way you don't have to keep checking your watch. You just set the timer, whether it's 3 minutes or 20 minutes or 30 seconds, and it sings to you when it's time to pay attention. Now, if you have something, he's got his feet in hot water now, and this is a real simple one, so he's just gonna sit with them for 20 minutes. If he has, say, high blood pressure, what this does is it shifts the blood by dilating the blood vessels in the legs, in the lower extremities, and so the blood shifts. Usually, oftentimes in high blood pressure, there's congestion somewhere up in the torso, and the blood pressure goes up. When you put the feet in hot water and the blood vessels dilate, the blood shifts down and it goes away from the area where it's being a problem, and the blood pressure goes down. The most common exception to this is if you have just heard from the tax assessor's office and they have told you that you have made a mistake in your last year's taxes and you are being audited. Then, because you're under stress and tension, it will lower it briefly, but it does not stay down. So, but barring that type of emotional anxiety and stress, this often works very well for blood pressure, and it's an easy, inexpensive thing to try. Again, it also works if you have a congestive headache, but now if you have a congestive headache, or if you have a sore throat with inflammation or chest congestion, it will shift the blood further south for you and it relieves the distress. But if you are using it for something like a migraine headache, then you need to do some additional things. And one of those is, would you kindly turn your head that direction for a moment? You want to put a towel that you have dipped into cold water, preferably with some ice in it, so it's ice water, and wrung out. You want to put back here at the back of the head, right in this area. This is a reflex zone for the brain. Okay, you can look forward again. And then you want a second one. I need a third hand on this. Where you have dipped it in cold water, because right up here is another reflex zone for the brain. This way, it causes the blood vessels in the head, thank you, it causes the blood vessels in the brain to constrict, forcing out any excess blood that is up there that's causing the congestion. And with the feet, the blood vessels being dilated, the blood shifts down into the legs instead, and it relieves the pressure in the head. Very simple. Okay. And I'll
along with us just a moment. Now I need you to, we're going to need to move this over. You can keep it, I just need to move it over a moment. Oops. Hopefully I got these words right. I don't know Tagalog, so I looked it up on the internet. This is what it said. Okay. The next treatment is where you need your timer, and it's a hot and cold foot leg treatment, and it is used for, this is where the old eyes require glasses. It promotes circulation. Somebody's laughing. There's somebody who uses glasses, I can tell. They promote circulation for the legs, and they balance circulation for the legs, including in diabetics. This is an awesome, awesome treatment for diabetics. When you read the old hydrotherapy books that occurred back in Ellen White's days, what they tell you is that if you do it for roughly 30 minutes, you can gain 95% normal circulation in the legs. That's not bad for a half hour, basically free treatment. Okay? I've seen diabetic foot ulcers, big ones, size of a large coin, what we call a silver dollar in the United States, on the bottom of somebody's foot heal up in just 3 weeks. I've seen leg ulcers heal up. I've seen diabetics who had numbness up to their knees regain the feeling in their legs. I've seen some amazing things that have occurred with this for diabetics. It also increases the lymphatic flow. It's excellent for sprains and strains. In particular, after the initial 48 hours, because they say you should apply only cold the first 48 hours, but after that, you start doing the hot and cold treatments every day, and it dramatically increases how quickly the sprain or strain heals. It also works for impaired venous circulation, and it even works for insomnia. They say don't use it for diabetic neuropathy, but that's because you have to be very careful on the temperature. Because people who have lost the feeling in their legs, partially or completely, can't tell how hot the water is, and you don't want them to get burned. Where normally you can go up with your temperature of the hot water up to about 42 degrees, Celsius, with diabetics, you don't want it to go above 39. So that's important. That keeps it in a safe zone. If you have cancer of the legs, in the legs, you're not going to do this treatment because you don't want it to possibly spread. If you have something called advanced peripheral vascular disease, you're not going to use it. And if you have a tendency to hemorrhage. And those are about the only contraindications. So, 3 minutes in the hot water, and then your dinger dings, and you're going to do 30 seconds in the cold water. And then you're going to do another 3 minutes in the hot water. And you're going to do 30 seconds in the cold. You're going to do this 6 times. And you don't need the extra things. You're just working with the lower extremities. It actually trains the legs. And like with diabetics, diabetics lose, for some reason,
lose some of the ability of the blood vessels to constrict and to dilate. And this teaches them to do it again. And literally, the first time, the hot water just feels good. And then they put it the 30 seconds, anybody, even you. I used to do this with my students. And I'd make them all, we had a big laundry room that was off the school, and I made them all go in there and take a chair, and we had lots of buckets, and we'd sit down and we'd pair off, and we'd practice giving it to somebody, and then we'd get it. And after you've had your feet in the hot water for 3 minutes and you put it in the cold, at the end of 30 seconds, the people are going, is the time up yet? My ankles are really aching. Well, that was a sign that the blood vessels had constricted. And then they would put it in the hot. And the people would go, ooh, it's getting itchy now. That was a sign that the blood vessels were dilating. And so you dilate, constrict, it pumps the excess fluid, the edema, etc., out of the legs, but it also rehabilitates the blood vessels so that they remember how to dilate and constrict so that they can work properly for you. Okay, thank you very much. You've been a very good. Let's give our volunteer a hand. And thank you. And I'm not sure where we are in time, so I don't know if there's any minutes left over for a question or two, or if we need to. It's okay. I think we're at the end of our 20 minutes, so thank you very much.
We are entering into the final phase of our fasting and prayer. At this time, we are going to have two churches from Tagaytay. Pastor Lee, can you tell the remaining two churches that can sing for us? Mendez, are you ready? Please come forward. And we're also going to have another one followed. I'm going to call upon Dr. Ben Mergal. After this, we will have a small season of prayer, and then I will call him. In the meanwhile, we would like to call upon Mendez, and we will have one song before his sermon and one after. Okay, Pastor? That will be the one. I will want all of us to gear up because we are getting ready to go to the pinnacle, and we're going to pray in a special way. Mendez, will you please come forward? Thank you. We've spent a couple of hours in the presence of God, praying, interceding. We've also spent considerable amount of time studying the word and also in listening to songs. What good will it do if we do not consecrate our lives? We are entering the last few minutes of the most beautiful session of consecration. But before we do this, I will be very happy if all of us can kindly stand wherever we are. I want to especially invite the Spirit of God to speak to us very sincerely and earnestly. Lord, we want to dedicate our lives, want to dedicate our future, want to dedicate also our talents. But we can never do this, Lord, without you. At this moment, we are here to consecrate ourselves, but we want to know what it is to be an authentic Christian. Is it just enough for us to attend a prayer meeting, fast and pray? But we have to be agents. We have to be ambassadors. We have to be evangelists. This great city of Tagaytay has to be reached for God. And as we are going to listen to a consecration sermon, please anoint your servant, Dr. Mergal, and may the Spirit flow through him. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I would like to call upon my beloved professor and my pastor, Dr. Mergal. He is the Applied Theology Department Chair of the Adventist International Institute of Advanced Studies. I want to very specially welcome him as he leads us into this consecration. Amen.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Let us praise God this evening for this wonderful opportunity in which we can be together and participate in this prayer wave. The Lord has blessed us so much, hearing a lot of testimonies and also prayers helping us to become strong in our relationship with God. As the conclusion of this prayer wave, let me study with you the spiritual habits of an authentic Christian. Why I would like to share this very important topic, because today the problem in the church is so much on spirituality. So let me share some thoughts about the spiritual habits of an authentic Christian, referring to the Seventh-day Adventist Church members. Let us remember that Mrs. Ellen G. White said, higher than the highest human thought can reach is God's ideal for his children. Godliness, Godlikeness is the goal to be reached. Education, page 20. And if you are going to study the book of Timothy, particularly 1 Timothy 4:8, it says that physical exercise is beneficial, but godliness profiteth all. So when we talk about godliness, we are talking about spirituality. We are talking about spiritual character. So we want to make sure that every Christian is right with God in his head, his heart, his hand, and his habit. And when we talk about his head, we are talking about the wise person. That's God's ideal for his children. And when we talk about the heart, we're talking about a godly, loving person. And if we talk about the hand, we are talking about the skilled person and the habit. We are talking about spiritually disciplined person. That's our goal. That is our focus as far as godliness and godlikeness is concerned. 1 Peter 5, 5-6. Let us revisit this particular text for our consideration this evening. According to Peter, all of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Let us remember that humility is one of the components of spirituality. And he said further, humble yourselves therefore under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Humility and then lifting up. To avoid being consumed by the rat race and the pressure of life, all Christians need strategies and spiritual habits that will help them stay on purpose. And when we talk about humility, we are talking about spirituality, and spirituality is very, very important when it comes to our life. So let me continue. What is habit? Because our purpose in this study this evening is to help us understand what should be the spiritual habits that spiritual Christians should have. Well, habits are the customary activities we do in life. But when we talk about habits, these are not things that happen just in a vacuum. Habits are done in level of consciousness and sometimes with impulse. As habits become integrated into the life system and becomes fixed, now it becomes character. That's why it's very, very important that our attitude, our habits should be godly, because the impact, of course, is seen in our spiritual character. That's why David said, Lord, incline not my heart to any evil thing, to practice. And practice there refers to habitual actions. Practice wicked works with men that work iniquity, and let me not eat of their dainties. So here, David was really asking God, Lord, help me to live a life that is patterned unto you, spiritual life. But while it is true that we are looking for a spiritual life, authentic spiritual life, there are always problems that are confronting us as Christians. And I would like to share some of the spiritual problems to you this afternoon. Well, let me share some of the gaps I have shared this already, but I would like to reiterate this one just for the sake of emphasis. Well, we have built nice and attractive houses, but the problem is we have not established strong foundation of our homes. We have mastered the fastest and the most convenient methods of communication, but the problem is we have difficulty in finding time to talk with God. That's spirituality. We have pledged to share the gospel commission, but the problem is we have failed to live up to the sermon of Jesus on the Mount. That's our study this morning. We have solved the mystery of the atom, but not our prejudice. We have reached the outer space, but the problem is we have not solved the problem of our inner selves. We are successful in brain and heart surgeries, but we fail to control the lust of the flesh. We have discovered the fastest mode of travel, but we have difficulty walking through the safest highway to life. We master the verse, love one another, but the problem is we have more dissensions, conflicts, hates, and fights with one another. We have used the most expensive gadgets and technology to make us beautiful and handsome, but the problem is we have polluted our souls. We have adopted the most fashionable dress design to make ourselves attractive, but we have failed in compassion to attract souls for Christ. We have spent so much, exercised so much, applied diet therapy so much to trim and structure our body, but have failed to spend more and to cross more streets to meet our neighbors. We believe in the urgent call to preach the gospel, but the problem is most of the time we preach the gossip. We have discovered medicines to improve our heights and to reduce our sizes, but the problem is we have failed to shape our spirituality. We sing each one touch a heart, but by our enthusiasm and carelessness, we detach from one another. We sing in the heart of Jesus, but we lost the passion for souls. We say, Lord, speak to your servant, but in most ways, we talk like a machine gun. We memorize the verse, pray without ceasing, but without ceasing, we say more and complaints. We rush and occupy ourselves for the sake of the work of the Lord, but the problem is we fail to find the quality time for the Lord of the work. We worship our work as a way of life, but not work of truly worship in truth and spirit. We worship as an obligation, but not for discipleship. We play to ventilate ourselves from tensions and stress, but less intentional to pray for spiritual healing and forgiveness. And we are very happy this morning that we have this opportunity in which we can pray together, experiencing God's healing in our lives. We fill our thoughts with things of the world, but less time in the meditation of God's word. That's the problem of spirituality. We fight for human right, but the problem is we are not consistent to live what is life. We always endeavor to safeguard our reputation, but the problem is we don't care about our spiritual character. So there is a gap of our spirituality, spiritual habit. The gap between what we know to what we do. The gap between what we believe to what we live spiritually. The gap between what is living to what is life. The gap between our religious profession to our position in our spirituality. The problem with us Christian, particular Seventh-day Adventist, we carry ourselves so much that we have no more weight for God. We love ourselves so much that we lost our love for God. We work much for ourselves that we have no more work for God. We spend much time for ourselves that we have no more time for God. We desire so much for control that God have no more control in our lives. We desire more product than undergo a spiritual process of Christian living. Friends, today, brethren, today, this is our experience as far as spirituality is concerned. But what is the cause of the problem? Well, the cause of the problem is traceable to the time of Adam and Eve. Lucifer came down into this world and started tempting our first mother, Eve. And the temptation was to be like God. That was the original temptation. Lucifer said, "You will not surely die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." That is recorded in Genesis 3, 4 to 5. So all of us at times think we are God, or at least want to be God. That's the problem. We want to become independent from God. We want to be like God. And that's the proposition of Lucifer. Act as if the universe revolves around us, show off our power, flaunt our egos, take the throne to control our little worlds. In other words, we are obsessed with selfish pride, with independence, and self-exaltation. And if this thing is in our life, brethren, for sure, our spirituality will be affected. So pride and selfishness is today the problem of many, many Christians, including Seventh-day Adventists. So when we define pride and selfishness, pride is an exaggeration of our worth and power, overrating our superiority, and possessing unreasonable conceit. So we say, "Oh, I'm higher than he is. I'm like God. I'm like this. I am more than him." Its synonyms are vanity, conceit, arrogance, egotism, boastfulness, selfishness. It has been recognized since ancient times as to be the root of cruelty and evil. In fact, according to Augustine, if you are proud, as if you are registering your application in heaven, and you are waiting for the vacancy of the Trinity. That is what it means by pride. So pride and selfishness together is actually the essential vice. It is considered as the utmost evil. Pride is the mother of all vices. It is the complete anti-God state of mind. It is always looking up to ourselves and looking down on the things and people. It is, as I have mentioned already, an application waiting for a vacancy in the Trinity. And friends, we have several forms of pride. We have intellectual pride, which leads to bigotry. We have to be very careful of this. We have professional pride, which leads to jealousy and competition. We have emotional pride, which leads to sentimentalism. We have religious pride, which leads to religious legalism. And we have material pride, which leads to hoarding and competition. We have different of all these prides. And this is the problem of our spirituality today. So the problem is of pride is, pride blinds us. Pride blinds us of the realities of heaven. Pride prevents our growth, our spiritual growth. And pride distorts our judgment. When we are proud, we cannot judge properly. We do not have the discernment, spiritual discernment, coming from God. Pride destroys not only our relationship with God, but it destroys our relationship with one another. Pride separates us from one another because it destroys relationship. Pride, according to Proverbs 16:18, goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. I hate pride and arrogance, evil behavior, and perverse speech, according to the wisest man who ever lived on earth. But friends, how to solve this problem? There are spiritual habits that we are going to consider. And this is what I call the paradigm shift. The paradigm shift. Why this is from kneeling to standing before God. This is from humility to victorious Christian life. And I would like to share to you the model. The first, I would like to introduce to you the model of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the model of spirituality. Jesus Christ is the model of prayer. Jesus Christ is the model of victorious life. And I cannot introduce anyone, any person higher than that of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our model. That's why Paul said, you have to imitate me because I have imitated Jesus Christ. The first habit is the habit of prayer. I think we have manifested it this afternoon. We can see the power of prayer. Prayer is very important. In fact, this is a demonstration of our relationship to God. It is a way of talking to Jesus Christ, talking to God. It is sharing our need to Him. That, Lord, we are in need of your power. We are in need of your help. That's why the posture of our heart is more important than the posture of the body. That's very important in prayer. Prayer is very, very important. I believe in prayer, my friends. I have given a testimony of how my prayer was answered. I was a district leader in East Visayan Mission. When I prayed for the sick person, even myself, I could not believe that the Lord will heal instantly that individual. But because of the power of prayer, the person was healed. 2 years ago, I was going to General Santos City. And I was flying with Cebu Pacific. And suddenly the pilot said, ladies and gentlemen, we have to go back to Mactan Airport. We have to have an emergency landing because there is a technical problem of our plane. And I could see, brethren, the commotion inside the plane. And the woman sitting next to me was already crying. And she said, sir, tomorrow is my wedding. If this plane will crash, what will happen to our wedding? And started thinking about my property. I've started thinking about my profession. I started thinking about my beautiful wife. I prayed, Lord, please, for the sake of the ministry, I'm going to General Santos City to conduct a seminar for the pastors. So Lord, spare my life, and the Lord spared us. Habit of prayer. Well, there are facts about prayer. Prayer catapults us into the frontier of spiritual life. The discipline of prayer brings us into the deepest and highest work of the Spirit. Prayer is life-creating and life-changing. The closer we come to the heartbeat of God, the more we see our need, and the more we desire to be conformed to Christ. Prayer is a secret, fervent, believing prayer lies at the root of the personal godliness, according to William Carey. So, prayer is very, very helpful, very beneficial to Christians, because prayer brings clarity of mind in time of decision. It keeps you in accord with God's plan and purpose. It enables you to face the trials of life. It leads you to a transformed life. It brings victory over the enemy. That's why prayer is very, very important. Another habit to combat pride and selfishness is the habit of dwelling in His Word. According to David, His Word is the light, or the light and the lamp unto our feet. That's why we should develop a habit of dwelling in His Word. Let us not stop reading His Word, meditating His Word. We cannot afford to empty our mind. Let us fill our minds with His words. That's why there are ways to cultivate the habit of dwelling in His Word. First, we have to hear the Word by faith. It's not just an ordinary browsing of God's word, but we have to hear the word by faith. We believe that this is God's word. We read the word. We study the word. And then we even go deeper. We have to memorize his word. And not only memorizing his word, but we have to meditate on the word so that it will sink deep into our hearts and it will be registered in our mind. And then we apply the word in our life. That is ways to cultivate the habit of dwelling in his word. Prayer, Bible study, these are spiritual practices, disciplines that will help us combat pride and selfishness. Another habit is the habit of being one with another. We are human beings. We need to belong to one another. We need to have that relationship. Yes, we need to have that vertical relationship, but our horizontal relationship with one another is very, very important. That's why Apostle Paul always encouraged Christians to be loving with one another. And I would like to share, I always share this to the brethren. My purpose is, while we are here, let us develop that kind of relationship. Because by having this kind of relationship, then our spirituality will become strong. And I would like to read statements from the Bible of how we will be able to develop that relationship, strong relationship with one another. Paul said, accept one another, be devoted to one another, be kind and compassionate to one another, be patient, bearing with one another, carry each other's burdens, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, confess your sins to each other, don't grumble against each other, do not lie each other, do not slander one another, do what leads to peace and mutual edification, encourage one another. But there are more. Paul said, serve one another in love. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. That's what we do this afternoon. Stop passing judgment on one another. Spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Submit to one another. Very, very important. Husbands and wives, leaders and members in the church. Teach and admonish one another. Forgive one another. Have equal concern for one another. Honor one another. Live in harmony with one another. Love one another. Offer hospitality to one another. Pray for each other. Friends, those are the habits of being one. And if we have that kind of relationship in the family and also in our church, for sure, we will be developing a very good kind of spirituality that is ideal in the church and also in the community. Another habit that we are going to develop in our spirituality is the habit of changing our value system.